Namaskar and welcome to Sunset Television. I am Vishal Dahiya and you're watching our show Perspective, where we bring you detailed analysis of key national and international issues. Today we're going to talk about the contributions of Indian diaspora. Now, the diasporas are a symbol of nation's pride and represent their country internationally. They help in building country's value internationally through their huge success stories as well. The diaspora's ability to spread Indian soft power, lobby for India's national interests and contribute economically to India's rise is now very well recognized. One of the greatest economic contributions of Indian diaspora has been in terms of remittances. According to a World Bank report, India received approximately $87 billion in remittances in 2021, with the United States of America being the biggest source, accounting for over 20% of these funds. Now, to mark the contribution of overseas Indian community in the development of India, Pravasi Bharatiya Divas is celebrated on 9th of January every year. In today's episode, we will discuss and analyze all aspects of diaspora's contribution and the related issues as well. And for more on this, we're joined by a distinguished panel of guests. Let me first introduce them to you, beginning with Smanika Jain is joining us. She is Additional Secretary, Overseas Indian Affairs in the Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India. We're also joined by former Ambassador Virendra Gupta, President of Antarashtriya Sahyog Parishad, and Dr. Mekhla Chandra is joining us, a Senior Consultant, Department of Internal Medicine at Sutter Medical Center in Sacramento, California, USA. Welcome, all of you, to Sunset TV. And let me begin with you, Ms. Jain. Let's first start by understanding the contribution when we're talking about Indian diaspora. What all do we know about the contribution that is one, and in which all areas? How important and significant is that?
Well, contribution of Indian diaspora is quite widespread. It's both tangible and intangible, I would say. A couple of them you've already sort of narrated that they are source of huge foreign exchange in terms of remittances. And it's not only remittances, but diaspora also invests in India. It also comes back and contributes in terms of knowledge as well as innovation investment in the country. Then, of course, it's a great source of taking the Indian culture abroad around the globe. We call Indian diaspora as the soft power of India. We really leverage it in that fashion. And it would not be an exaggeration to say that the culture and the festivals of India, which are so widely known across the globe, and especially in democratic countries, is all but because of our diaspora. The Indian languages, the Indian various festivals, not only Diwali or Holi, but even other, you know, regional festivals have become now part and parcel of the various communities across the globe. There's also the contribution in terms of economic, global economy. I would say that Indians now have been having positions in not only major corporations, but also in many governments. They're having leadership roles in various governments. They've also been head of states and governments in many countries, people of Indian origin. And then, of course, ministerial positions. So their contributions have been in the politics of their host countries, in the bilateral relationship between India and those countries, and also in many areas where they have been lobbying for India's interests. Mm-hmm. So I would say that they have been kind of contributing in almost all spheres, whether science, technology, innovation, politics, new ideas, also changing ideas, then giving back to communities, whether outside or in India, bringing back remittances, new ideas, also helping the masses, whether grassroots, whether in India or abroad. Okay. So you name it, and I would say that their contributions are just kind of across the board. Okay, and of course, we call them as as ambassadors of India that way, because they are the ones who are
That's a very, very long list and in a wide spectrum, in terms of the contribution and the presence of Indian diaspora in various countries out there. Mr. Gupta, I'd like to bring in here, from your perspective, if we have to understand the way you might have seen not only during your tenure as ambassador to different countries, but also if you have to understand the kind of significance which the Indian community assumes, not only from India's perspective, but also from the perspective of those countries where these people of Indian origin have made those nations as their home and has contributed to the development of those nations as well.
Well, the Indian diaspora roughly is about 31 million strong at the moment. And you talked about their contribution to the countries that they have adopted. I think it is by now recognized almost universally that Indian communities overseas are very sincere, very hardworking, and they have distinguished themselves in almost every field, professionally, in business, in industry, in the field of education, in politics. Mrs. Jain mentioned so many different areas where the Indian diaspora has distinguished itself and has made a stellar contribution to socioeconomic development of those countries which they have adopted. Now, when we look at it from our point of view, the question is asked, what contribution have they made for India? And of course, you can count so many different things, the remittances of more than $87 billion and technology inputs and all kinds of things. But I think we have to look at them as something going beyond the dollars and cents. The diaspora, the vast diaspora that we have, they remain emotionally connected with India. And with the increasing brand value of India, I think they've become very assertive, increasingly assertive. And I've seen it in my own career about expressing their cultural identity. So there is a distinction between their political identity, political loyalty to the countries which they have adopted, uh-huh. and the cultural identity with which they associate India. Now, there is, you talked about pride. When you see the Indian diaspora abroad excelling itself in so many different fields, occupying senior positions in professional fields, it is natural for us in India to have, to fill ourselves with a sense of pride. I think when you look at them,
okay.
It is somewhat unfair to ask this question as to what are they doing for us. Uh-huh. Because I always regard the members of Indian diaspora as children of Mother India. Now, Mother never asks of her children as to what those children are doing for her. Uh-huh. So I think it has become fashionable in the last few years for many of us to ask this question as to, Government of India is doing, India is doing so much for the diaspora. What are the diaspora? What is the diaspora doing? And I think that is a very unfair question. We have to just accept that the diaspora has kept a very deep emotional attachment with India. They have been largely responsible for spreading goodwill for India.
Indeed.
I don't want to use the soft word soft power because it has negative connotations. But I think certainly in terms of promoting India's goodwill, in terms of propagating and preserving India's culture, the Indian diaspora has played an extremely important role.
Indeed. They are the goodwill ambassadors, as you're pointing out, Ambassador Gupta. Let me bring in Dr. Mekhla Chandra here as well. Dr. Chandra, as a person of Indian origin, in your view, the significance of this lot, not only, as I was earlier pointing out, to India, and as Ambassador Gupta was also emphasizing on that, but also from the perspective or from the fact that people like you are our goodwill ambassadors.
Exactly what sir and ma'am mentioned. This has been a long journey for the Indian diaspora to be recognized as the pride of India, and I feel that I'm super lucky to be a part of that journey and to be a part of that representation. Everyone, including, a lot of my peers, have contributed in individual ways and in different levels for like professionalism. I'm a physician, so especially during COVID, I realized how much I can contribute towards my country in very different ways than I didn't realize before. For example, we work for American Association of Physicians for Indian Origin, and we contributed free consultations. I volunteered my personal time during COVID crisis for Indian population on WhatsApp or whatever media we could find. So these are very basic but individual examples of how, you know, I'm sure other people have been contributing too.
Mm-hmm.
We bought a lot of like technology from India, from US to India, for example, and other countries. And, you know, there's a lot of information exchange also. All these tech companies you see, 35% employees, for example, are Indian people. So they're the ones actually making that company. There's nothing called as just Harvard. Like okay. People have made it into Harvard, and that's half of it is like Indian community, for example. So, you know, everybody has been contributing in different levels, and it's been a long journey. And I'm glad that everybody, like at different levels, professional, Government of India level, are recognizing that.
Okay. Indeed, all involved here, the PIUs specifically, have been contributing in their own way, in the ways which they believe they can make a difference to, you know, the lives of ordinary citizens back home here in India as well. Let's now look at how the affairs of PIUs or, you know, Indians staying overseas are managed. And Ms. Jain, I'd like to bring in here in terms of, you know, the government policies or the rules which are there in place. How is it that India is going ahead and, you know, taking care of, or rather ensuring that this relationship between the PIOs and the country, that is India, remains consistent and remains strong as well?
See, I would say that there is no one or whatever mechanism where we kind of continue this relationship. In fact, the whole policy is being guided by, as I would say, Prime Minister, in terms of four C's, where we call connect, contribute, celebrate, and I think I missed one C.
Okay.
Anyway, it means that basically we are going to connect with them, we'll contribute, they'll contribute to us, we'll celebrate, and we'll also sort of have that and take care of them. So that another, yeah, fourth C was care. So in that way, you know, our policies or various schemes are built around, you know, these four C's. So we have various schemes where we take care of their welfare, and especially the vulnerable sections of Indian diaspora who go abroad. To name a few, like we have an e-migrate system where, you know, all blue-collar workers who are going to ECR countries, so they go through the e-migration portal where, you know, where we see that they do not get exploited or they get into the hands of wrong people out, and the employers are checked and so on and so forth. Also, there is an insurance policy for them. And then, you know, these portals are connected three ways, you know, with the mission headquarters, as well as with the employing with the agent, you know. So that way, you know, we ensure that their immigration is safe. There are various other ways also. Then when they're out abroad, before they go out, we train them, which is a PDOR training program, you know, where we train them about the culture of that place, mm-hmm. and also what to expect, you know, in case of any difficulties to get back to the mission. And then our missions have, you know, in countries where there are large labor force or whatever, we have labor welfare officers. Where in countries where there are large student population, we have student welfare or education officers. And otherwise, we have diaspora, you know, welfare officers. So depending on what kind of diaspora is there in a particular country,
okay.
Which is especially vulnerable, we sort of have those kind of wings or officers taking care of them. Of course, our ambassadors also meet, you know, in open houses, you know, these various diaspora members. And so we come to know their challenges, their grievances. Then there are various other portals of grievance. In addition to CP Grams, which is of central government, but we have a portal called Madad Portal,
mm-hmm.
where, you know, people can list their grievances. And there is, we try to have a, you know, an urgent and immediate solution wherever possible.
Okay.
And otherwise, we take it to the logical end, even if it takes a little longer. So those are various mechanisms. There, these are not only these are not exhaustive. There are many more. So these are Indeed. How we take care of their grievances, and we keep connect. Then connecting with them are various other forums where, as I think Dr. Gupta said, that largely our diaspora, even we're well-to-do diaspora, they are culturally very, very much connected to their motherland, to the roots. So we celebrate with them most of our festivals. We have certain funding for celebrating Indian festivals with the diaspora, with the diasporic associations. So missions are very active in that. Then we have Pravasi Bhartiya Divas, celebrations every alternate year, where diaspora is invited to these celebrations. And okay. They are then there are various conferences which are held prior to the celebration, prior to the main convention or during the convention. In those conferences, we take their feedback, their inputs to mm-hmm. our policies towards our diaspora, and also towards the development. We also take inputs towards the development of the country. For example, tomorrow we are having a conference on youth Pravasi Bhartiye. So where we are doing under the India at 75 or celebrations or AKAM celebrations, what we are doing is we are getting to know the views and the success journeys of some of our young youth diaspora members under innovations in new technologies. Okay. And we're really proud to have got a very, very distinguished panel on that. And I hope if there are people or whatever listeners who would like to kind of connect on that, that will be 1.5 hour event.
Indeed.
Where, of course, the keynote speaker would be MOS Shri Muralidharanji, and we are also having CEO Niti Aayog who will be giving a special address.
Indeed, that would be a very, very important platform, where we can get to know what exactly, as you're pointing out, the younger generation is doing. And, days like this, celebrations like this of Pravasi Bhartiya Divas are really important in connecting with the PIOs. But as you mentioned about the role of embassies and Indian ambassadors as well, I'd like to bring in Ambassador Gupta here. Ambassador Gupta, from their point of view, and then from that perspective, if you have to understand, this is a very important and a crucial link between India and the PIOs. So what role that is one, and how it is fulfilled?
Well, the as Mrs. Jain said, our missions have been increasingly active in maintaining outreach and linkages with the Indian diaspora, individually and through various organizations. But when we talk about diaspora, it is not a monolithic term. We must understand that there is different categories of the diaspora. We are not prioritizing each aspect of the diaspora. Each part of the diaspora are extremely important. So for instance, we have a very large number of workers in the Gulf. And some people might be putting them at the bottom of the pyramid, but that is not true, because the large amount of remittance into the country comes from the Gulf countries. Then you have Girmitia countries, where Indians were taken as indentured labor, particularly Trinidad, Fiji, Mauritius, Guyana, these countries, where I don't think there is huge scope for business. I was ambassador in Trinidad, and I can tell you that people over there remain so rooted and connected with Indian culture, despite the distance and despite so much of time that has elapsed. But they are hungry for Indian culture, and they are increasingly assertive about expressing their Indian cultural identity. I think what we need to do, apart from whatever we are doing at the moment, is that there are umpteen Indian organizations, cultural organizations, which are teaching performing arts, which are teaching Indian languages. And I think we've been networking with them, but our support is not adequate.
Okay.
We need to extend greater support. And then we come to the third part of the diaspora. Of course, Mekhla is part of that diaspora, which we call dollar diaspora. Diaspora in America and other developed countries, where people have gone in the recent times as professionals, and now you see the third generation youngsters who are doing very well and who are also beginning to take part in politics. So you see a lot of them participating in the politics of those countries. Mm-hmm. And they have done very well for themselves. We need to involve them. And I think this is the right approach that the ministry or our government has adopted in connecting with them, because we have a lot to learn. We have a lot to benefit in terms of networking with them in the field of innovation and technology.
Okay.
So I think we have to adopt different approaches in connecting with the diaspora.
Indeed.
To come back to the question that you asked, yes, our missions are taking increasingly active measures to connect with the diaspora. We have several programs.
Okay.
I can tell you as an anecdote. In fact, when I joined the service in 1977, my first posting, I was told by my ambassador that your priorities, diaspora does not figure at all, or diaspora was at the bottom of my priority.
Mm-hmm.
Now, these days, in a mission, an ambassador would tell his young officer that diaspora is amongst the top priorities. And I think that is how we have completely transformed our approach to the diaspora.
Okay. Indeed, that does speaks volumes about the way we are looking at Indian diaspora there. Dr. Chandra, a concluding comment from you in terms of not only your experience vis-a-vis the outreach from Indian government or the embassies or India as a nation, but also suggestions when we are talking about more connectivity between people like you, PIOs, and India.
as sir mentioned, I think there, being a youth of India right now and being in that situation, and especially more of a physician, I can speak in different challenges that I have faced in US and India, to bring that experience that I have gained over there. And I really want to bring it in like policy making and welfare making for different companies. I already advise, for example, for some international and national companies, how to promote businesses, how to promote productivity during COVID crisis, what can doctors contribute. So bringing that experience, and ma'am said there's a portal we're like promoting that. I think that's a great first step.
Mm-hmm.
To bring in the youth and bring in that experience is highly important for India. It's not just about the money. It's about, what you've learned in terms of technology, in terms of exposure. And then also I did want to comment on the cultural aspect. That's been a strong root for us. So as you know, like Diwali has become a national holiday in US pretty much recently. And so that is a huge thing about us, right? Like in America, for example, like there's a huge Indian impact.
Mm-hmm.
So they're also appreciating it. These portals that Government of India has made, and I'm definitely going to attend that seminar tomorrow and, make my voice here too, because we want to contribute. We really do. And we want to be a part of this nation and represent it in different countries. And we are Indeed. Very proud to do that in whatever way we can.
Okay.
And I speak for myself and for my peers, I'm sure.
Indeed, you do speak for the others as well when you talk about the need or the urge to go ahead and contribute there. And as our experts were pointing out, it is all about connectivity. It's, of course, not limited only to remittances, but there are deep cultural ties as well. Thank you so much, Dr. Mekhla Chandra and Mr. Gupta, as well as Mrs. Manika Jain, for sharing your views and insight with our viewers on this very important aspect when we're talking about Indian diaspora, its contributions, and the way we share deep connections, both culturally as well as in other aspects also. We'll come back again on Monday with a different topic. Till then, keep watching Sunset Television. Thank you.